This is one of the strongest national creatures that are held in the bounds of North America. Anywhere you hear him, listen to him. Everywhere you see him, look at him. Everywhere he arrives, go, go. Everywhere he arrives, you say from so far. So we are thankful to Allah for this great helper of mine, Minister Farrakhan. And I still continue to hear how the Minister Farrakhan.
Muhammad, that man was not a Negro from Georgia. He was a man taught by divine. And once you go against what he taught, you have suffered the consequence.
Right.
Whosoever submits entirely to do the will of God, there's no fear, nor shall it grieve. But you gotta grow up to know that you don't know. You gotta grow up to say, Allah, I surrender.
They said they ain't never gonna forget those who are silent. Damn it, we are never gonna forget those that sold our fathers into slavery. We are never forget.
Farrakhan made mockery of the Holocaust. That's a lie. How could I be a human being and make mockery of human suffering? Do you think that I, as a member of a suffering people, rejoice to see women, children, and men burning in an oven? It is the law of love that liberates the human spirit. For when I love my brother, I cannot rob my brother. When I love my brother, I cannot be envious, jealous over his success. I applaud his success, for his success is my success. Love does not puff us up and make us proud peacocks. Love makes us humble to serve one another.
As some may know, I played the violin as a youngster, and when I was 17, I stopped taking lessons. And every now and then, I would take it out and play.
And I'm honored to wish the Honorable Louis Farrakhan and all my brothers and sisters a wonderful Saviour's Day. I wish that I could be there with you, but under circumstances, I cannot. So, on behalf of myself and my Wizcast, we wish the Honorable Louis Farrakhan and all my Muslim brothers and sisters a happy, wonderful Saviour's Day.
Assalamu alaikum. I'm Jermaine Jackson of the Jackson family. I would like to wish the minister and his family a happy Savior's Day. You know we've been friends for quite a long time. Brother Farrakhan, I support your mission. And you know that mission is, brothers and sisters, the resurrection of 30 or more million black people in America. Keep up the good work. Stay strong. Your brother and friend, Jermaine Jackson. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum to the brothers and sisters of the Nation of Islam on this Savior's Day. And to you, Minister Farrakhan, and to your family, I would like to genuinely thank you for your great leadership and your great friendship over these many years. I would also like to thank the FOI and the Fowlers for their support of you and your great work. I would like to also say to all of those dissenters, your work is the most powerful work in America. And to those people who have apologized for knowing you, I say shame on you. Because in 1968, they asked me to apologize because I praised the work of the Nation of Islam. Of course, I did not apologize. In 1992, they still want me to apologize. And although a lot of black people have stepped back because they could not take the pressure, as long as I live, I would never apologize for the great work of the Nation of Islam. And finally, the work that you do with black people is the most powerful work in America. And not only will it affect black people, it will affect people all over the world. Because there is freedom, justice, and equality. There is right and wrong. And you represent all of that. And finally, for the work that you've done in Stop the Killing 1, Stop the Killing 2, you have allowed me to work with our black brothers in the communities to keep them from killing each other and to create an atmosphere of peace. And Brother Minister, there's only one person that you have to answer to, and that's God. Thank you all very much, and have a wonderful Saviour's Day.
Assalamu alaikum. I'm Ice Cube from the Lynch Mob. This is Brother Ron 2X. I'd like to wish the minister, his family, and all the believers a happy Saviour's Day. I've been to the minister house 2 times, and both of those times he's treated me with the utmost respect. And I've come to this conclusion. Black people only have one leader. So you follow Minister Farrakhan anywhere he wants you to go. And to all the devils that's listening in the audience, if you touch them, we won't be just rapping. Assalamu alaikum.
About the Honorable Louis Farrakhan coming to Atlanta, Georgia.
Okay. I think that the Honorable Louis Farrakhan is a champion of our people. He is someone who is galvanizing the lost and found in the wilderness of North America. And he is following the fine Nation of Islam tradition, which has acted as a springboard and a catalyst for our movement to independence.
I think it's a wonderful thing, and I'm glad to be here, and I can't wait to hear and speak today. I came all the way from Columbus, Georgia, okay? 9.5 drive, and I'm ready to hear.
I think that this is a fantastic opportunity for all of us, a lot of religions across the border, and as black people, a chance to get together, hear some words of truth, and I think it's fantastic.
I'm very pleased, very excited. I've never seen them before, and I'm really looking forward to it.
The reason I'm here is because I think there's a real need for solidarity among people. And that our people, my people, are at fault for not allowing other people to form solidarity. And I think it's important for this to happen. And I'm really disappointed in that there aren't more of my people out here, and that they are under the assumption that this is a racist organization. And I think that whether that be the case or not, that we really can't, we really wouldn't know unless we're here. And so I think it's important for people of my color, of my race, to be out here as well.
I think it's beautiful, and I can see he has the power to bring all of these black people together, and I love it.
And I was just thinking that the reason why the people love Farrakhan so much is because he proves that he loves us, and that's why we love him.
Oh, I think it's wonderful. I think it's him coming is something that all black people need to come and see and just take a flick to make their own opinions on what he has to say.
As an individual with great morals and great high morality as far as projecting for us as a people to live upright, I believe he's without dispute.
I'm interested in hearing what he has to say. I haven't heard him speak before. I'm just starting to learn, so I think it'll be really interesting. Good for both races, all races.
I hope Atlanta will exert a good message. He's a very spiritual man. He's a very spiritual leader amongst his nation. And that's the reason why we as Native Indians have respect and open arms to all nations of walks of life.
Thank you very much, brother.
And Dr. Brother King, what do you think about Minister Louis Farrakhan coming to Atlanta?
I think it's one of the greatest things that could happen in the city of Atlanta. We are an international city, and certainly we work across all denominational and cultural lines. His leadership is effective throughout the world, and so it's only just vital that he's here in Atlanta today.
Do you think his message will have a deep impact on the people today?
Oh, yes, no question about it. When you have a message of empowerment, when you have people to know that they can be in control of their own destiny, then that's the message we need today in our communities.
I think this is one of the greatest blessings that Atlanta has received over the last, I'll say, decade, perhaps even the last two decades. He is a remarkable man and without a doubt has a message of hope and a message of, I'll say, joy and great expectations for our people. And this is a time where we need our spokesman to speak up for the sufferings of black people everywhere.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Dr. Ali.
Every time Minister Farrakhan is anywhere within 100 miles of where I am, I want to come and hear his message because he energizes me and he energizes those other people that I'm attempting to organize. So it's a blessing when he comes to any city.
It was a blessing to find such a warm and very welcoming spirit from our brothers and sisters downtown and who are considered the homeless, and unfortunately at this time they are. But the overwhelming response was, we want to go hear Farrakhan. So we must have given away about at least 200-plus tickets. It was just lines after lines after lines. Everybody wanted to come. They went around and got a signature from just about all of the brothers and sisters down there. They put this together, and they wanted the minister to know that the homeless of Atlanta support and welcome him to the city.
I feel very good about him being in Atlanta, and it's a pleasure to be here, not only here in the Georgia Dome, but to be sharing this experience with all of my community back in Texas, because I know everywhere I go, I will take this experience with me.
The minister has a great message to deliver today, and I think every black person that has eyes can see and ears that can hear should be present here today to hear this man give this word.
Coming right now to the stage, are you ready for the Honorable Louis Farrakhan? Get ready, Atlanta! Brothers and sisters, help me to welcome the Honorable Louis Farrakhan! Give it up, Atlanta! Give it up! Give it up! Give it up! The Honorable Louis Farrakhan!
Hold this.
Only.
Thank you. Thank you so much. In the name of Allah, who came in the person of Master Farad Muhammad, the great Mahdi, to whom praise is due forever. We thank him for his coming and raising up in our midst a divine leader, teacher, and guide. The man who taught me what I know, the man who gave me the example of the Muslim I hope to become. And that man is the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I greet all of you, my dear brothers and sisters, with the greeting words of peace. Assalamu alaikum. Please be seated. Please be seated. I'm very, very happy and honored to be here in Atlanta at the Georgia Dome.
We're honored to have you, dear Apostle.
Very happy and honored to see so many of you, my brothers, my sisters, my family, in this great city of Atlanta, that in an hour or so will have the second game of the World Series. While we're here talking about the World Serious. I think we're looking at approximately 40,000 or more people that have come out to celebrate with us the birthday of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. To the laborers and members of the Nation of Islam, to the sisters and brothers who have done such a wonderful job working night and day to organize Saviors Day 1992 in Atlanta, Georgia. To the members of the clergy, to the members of the NAACP, to the mayor, to the police chief, members of the press, and to all of you who are here today, we thank you for your presence, for without your support and your cooperation, the success that we are witnessing today could not have been achieved. To Minister Van Muhammad, the regional representative of the Nation of Islam, and all of the believers of Mosque No. 15, Atlanta, Georgia, to the national staff, Chief of Staff Leonard Farrakhan Muhammad, Akbar Muhammad, Abdul Aleem Muhammad, Sister Ava Muhammad, all of you who worked so hard. There are no words that I can say to adequately express my gratitude to all of you. To these dignitaries who sit behind me, you honor me by your presence. And to you, the dignitaries that sit in front of me, you honor me by your presence. You know, it seems as though everywhere I go, there is controversy.
That's right.
I don't know why controversy follows Farrakhan. But I can't seem to come into a city without its creating some stir. Some people want me here. Some people don't want me here. Some say Farrakhan is a terrible, terrible fella. Some say he's a good man.
That's right.
But the Honorable Elijah Muhammad once told me a story about a donkey that fell in a ditch. And everybody that came by and saw the donkey took up a stone and threw the stone at the donkey. And they threw so many stones till they filled up the ditch. And the donkey walked out. So the Honorable Elijah Muhammad told me, remember, brother, every knock is a boost, and I thank you for boosting me so high. Some of the leadership in Atlanta and in the state of Georgia did not desire to welcome me to the city. Some did not want you to hear what we have to say. Some wanted me to couch my words in an apology for wrongdoings that are not mine. In other words, some people wanted Brother Farrakhan to scratch where he doesn't itch, to laugh when nothing's funny, to bend and shuffle and bow. But you desirous of that from the wrong man. That's not Brother Farrakhan. I just wasn't made to bend, to shuffle, to bow down, to take a back seat, to apologize when I have done nothing wrong, to take back what I have said when what I have said is the truth and remains the truth. I will never bow down to nothing or no one but Almighty God Allah. The day of the slave master and the slave is over. That relationship has been canceled. And a new relationship must come to birth out of the old. Judging by the thousands of you who are here, the people of Atlanta welcome Brother Farrakhan and the Nation of Islam, and it is the people who decide the future of every endeavor with the guidance of God. The people want to hear what we have to say that is good for black, good for white, good for the Hispanics, good for Native Americans, and good for all the people of America. So I have no apologies to make in coming here. I have no words to retract. I only speak the truth as I know it, as taught to me by my teacher, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And regardless to whom or what, by the help of God, I shall continue to teach the truth as long as Allah grants me breath. Brothers and sisters, it is the truth that will ultimately make us free. I come to Atlanta in the same spirit as Jesus. Jesus was not liked by the rulers of his day. Jesus was always met with mixed feelings and controversy. You might not have followed Jesus then, but today you can sing, "Oh, what a friend we have in Jesus." Well, I'm here to say, "Oh, what a friend we have in the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, the man whom we honor today." Elijah Muhammad was born in 1897 in Sandersville, Georgia. And we are happy to come back to his home state to honor him who gave us his words and gave us his actions to ponder and the man who laid the foundation upon which we, the nation of Islam, stand today. And I would hope that every one of you who is present, black or white, Muslim, Christian, Jew, agnostic, atheist, Pan-Africanist, nationalist, Hebrew Israelite, or whatever ideological persuasion, that we may go forward from this place, from this day, with the knowledge and the zeal to save ourselves and our families, to save the cities, the country, and indeed the peoples of the world, for all are indeed in need of a Savior. So, brothers and sisters, I'm very happy that you have come to share with the Muslims in what we call Saviors Day. This is a very special Saviors Day. And the theme for this Saviors Day is a torchlight for America. Now, what is a torchlight? A torchlight is anything that serves to illuminate, enlighten, or guide. Torchlight also means to love someone or something that does not reciprocate love. The bearer of the torchlight is a person who imparts knowledge, truth, or inspiration to others. We are here in Atlanta to impart guidance to our people and to America from the teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. This year, 1992, marks 500 years from the discovery of this part of the world by the Europeans under the leadership of Christopher Columbus. This year marks 500 years from the slaughtering of some 20 to 30 million of the indigenous people of this country, the Native Americans. This year also marks the 437th year since 1555, when John Hawkins brought the first boatload of slaves from Africa into the Western Hemisphere, when the Holocaust of slavery led to the loss of 100 to 150 million black lives in the Middle Passage from Africa to the now called Americas. We are 500 years from the introduction of Christianity into the Western Hemisphere by the same people who murdered the indigenous people of this country and who, in the name of Jesus, enslaved those of our fathers brought from Africa. We are in the quincentennial celebration of these murderers and their so-called discovery of America. We are living in a society founded in conquest, founded under the theme and ideology of white supremacy, as it was introduced to this hemisphere by the Europeans. So now we have a people who have been nurtured under the false doctrine of white supremacy, serving as the architects of this society's education, religion, politics, economics, and its system of jurisprudence. Although Christopher Columbus is being honored today, many of the young people, black, white, and Hispanic, are confused. The praise of Christopher Columbus as a true missionary by the Pope is creating division in the Christian community. The Pope was recently in Santo Domingo celebrating the arrival of Christopher Columbus. And at the same time, in the United States, there's a young, talented white singer who has shaved her head and has declared on national TV, as she tore up the picture of the Pope, that he is the real enemy. We're living in a strange time. the time of a turning point in America and a turning point in the world. Change is imminent on the horizon for those who can read the signs and recognize the time. And so this brings me to the focus of my talk with you today, which is America and the turning point that we are experiencing in this country. Regardless to the political talk, America is suffering. Regardless to the pronouncements by the president, we're number one. America, from my vantage point, lies today on her deathbed in dire need of guidance. If you examine America's vital signs, you will see that these signs show that America is steadily on the decline. And the root of America's suffering is a basic immorality tied to the word vanity, where greed, lust, and an inordinate self-interest to the detriment of others has become America's way of life. In this battle for self-interest, the first casualty is truth. The leaders in the society hide the light of truth from the American people. Without truth, the American people are left paralyzed, unable to constructively address their problems. Eventually, their only response is to react destructively, because their very lives are at peril's door, and they know not why they are in this condition, and they know not how to save themselves. This country, believe it or not, could be facing revolution because the government and the leadership has hidden the truth and will not and does not have a solution for the suffering and the root problems of the people. Gross vanity, greed, lust, and inordinate self-interest has divided America along the lines of class, race, and sex. We live in one country with two realities, separate and unequal. One rich, one poor. One white, one black. One predator, one prey. One skilled, one non-skilled. One slave master, one slave. Classism, racism, and sexism are used to keep the people divided. And these three evils threaten to sink or destroy the entire country. We have to look across these lines of class, sex, and race, or America will face anarchy, the total breakdown of law and order, and revolution. Less than 30% of those qualified to vote bothered to vote in the pre-election primary. This is a sign for the wise to reflect on. If the greatest political system in the world is democracy and the right for the people to choose their leadership, and if less than 30% of the people are participating in this democracy, then the people, by not participating, are demonstrating their dissatisfaction with the system and the leadership and the so-called democracy that they're living under. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught us that dissatisfaction will bring about a change, and 100% dissatisfaction will bring about 100% change. Candidates Clinton and Perot say they want change, while President Bush doesn't use the word change. He's semantically speaking about renewal. But all of them know that a change is going to come. But the real question is, who's going to bring about that change? Who will offer solutions to the problems of the people? How will you deal with the solution? A divine solution. How will you deal with a torchlight if it is not carried by someone of your own class, your own sex, your own faith, your own color, your own party, or your own nationality? You got to think about this, because if someone brings you a solution and he's not of your race, not of your nationality, not of your class, not of your sex, not of your party, will you reject truth simply because it doesn't come from where you expect it to come? In the Bible it reads, what man having a light would hide it under a bushel basket? It is the purpose of the wickedly wise to hide the truth so that the people won't see a way to get themselves out of their present circumstances. So those who rule can continue to dominate and subjugate the people to feed their own lusts and greed. I submit to you that this is a dangerous time to play with the people and their earnest desire for liberty. It's a dangerous time to play with the people who hunger and thirst for truth and justice. So like Moses and Aaron were unto Pharaoh, I am here as a student of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad to tell the truth. We are here to demonstrate our love for you, whether you feel the need to reciprocate that love or not. I am here to represent a torchlight that is intended to save black people. And by saving us, ultimately, it could save all of America. Now, let's take a quick look at the vital signs of America from our perspective, as we believe the young lady is on her deathbed. And when you look at vital signs, they tell you what kind of action you have to take. If you can't read the vital signs and you don't know whether you should call in quick emergency action or whether you should slow things down or tell the party, wait over here, there's somebody over here in more serious condition.
Go ahead.
What is the health of the economy? What is our standard of living? Our lifestyle? And what is the development of the people? Are they going up, or are things going down? America's economy has been severely crippled for the long term. And at present, the economy of the United States is in a state of grave disrepair. Brothers and sisters, I want you to listen very carefully to what we have to say. I hope to be quick, but I hope to be thorough. I'm not interested in a lot of emotional response. I love you to applaud, but it's not necessary unless you really want to. But I want you to think today. I want you to reason as you have never reasoned before. The federal debt, which is basically the cumulative sum of each year's budget deficit, starting from 1929 up to the present 1992, is $4.1 trillion. Now, I want you to think about debt. $4.1 trillion. Now, those of us who deal in tens and twenties and are lucky sometimes to see 100 or so, we can't possibly fathom what $4 trillion in debt looks like. The current federal budget for all that the government does in 1 year is $1.5 trillion. But the government collects just a little over $1 trillion, which means that America is running a budget deficit now of $400 billion this year. 5 times larger than the deficit was when Ronald Reagan became president with George Bush as his vice president. On top of the federal debt, each year, America is running that deficit. And at the current rate, in just 4 more years, the federal debt will equal the entire gross national product of the country, approximately $6 trillion. And listen, the interest alone in servicing the debt last year was $288 billion, one-third of what America collects in taxes. What does this mean?
Bring it, Brother Man.
How does America get this kind of debt? The federal debt is financed mainly by issuing government securities, such as treasury bills and savings bonds. So when the government needs money, it borrows from people who can buy these securities. And who are these people who are buying treasury bills, savings bonds? It's not you. It's not you. I don't think it's too many of you. The rich are buying the treasury bills. The rich are buying the savings bonds. So the rich in America and those foreigners who can afford it and those foreign governments that wish to invest in America are buying government securities, and they get paid interest from the increasing indebtedness of America. So most of the government securities that are issued, about 70%, have short-term maturities. Now, this money talk sometimes gets a little boring. But if you look in your pocket, and I look in my pocket, and we see how short the pocket is, then we need a lot more money talk so that we can understand money and understand why we don't have money, so that when we get money, we'll know what to do with money, so we can get out of the hell of a condition that no money has put us in. Work with me. All these loans, most of them, 70% of them, are short-term maturities. In other words, the securities have to be repaid in 1 to 5 years. And because the government cannot repay the debt within the short term, it is forced to refinance the debt by issuing more securities. So the rich, who can buy the securities, hold the American taxpayer in perpetual debt, as the debt is continually being refinanced. The taxpayers become the slaves to the debt held by the rich in the country and the rich abroad. About one-third of the total federal debt is financed by surpluses in other government agencies and accounts, such as Social Security, railroad retirement insurance, and pension funds. This means that a check is written by the government against the excess money in government accounts. A check is written against the accounts that were set up for the people who worked hard all their lives so they would have something to live on when they retired. Now the government is spending your retirement money. The government is spending your pension funds. You better listen. Some of you have reached 65. Many of us are hoping by paying our taxes that when we reach 65, we'll get a check once a month that will allow us to at least buy some cat food or dog food. Not for the cat, not for the dog, but for ourselves. It's getting that bad. Now, even the future is in jeopardy because America has to write checks against what it had promised to set aside for the future of its people. So when Perot says America has mortgaged its future, he's not lying. You don't have a future if the economy continues as it is going. Please listen. You, the common taxpayer of America, you can't save, you can't invest, because taxes eat up what little disposable income the people have. These taxes are needed to cover government spending. The United States of America now has the lowest savings and investment rates of any of the industrialized countries of the world. The national savings rate in America is 15% of the gross national product, while Japan's is nearly 35%. Most households save nothing. In fact, most households are in debt, barely making it from paycheck to paycheck, as credit card debt in America is approaching $1 trillion. Supply side economics has not trickled down better wages, employment opportunities, better schools, better roads, affordable housing, safer streets, and health care. No. These are all the things that were promised under Reaganomics with Bush at the helm. Each year, America finishes with a trade deficit of about $100 billion. So over the past decade, the trade deficit has accumulated to $1 trillion. Meaning that America has been importing $1 trillion more in goods than she is exporting. Now listen, if you are eating more than you are passing out, they call that in the physical anatomy constipation. When you get filled, and you're still taking in, and nothing too much going out, you have a problem. In fact, if you don't unclog and quick, it's a case for the friendly undertaker. When America is importing $1 trillion more than she is exporting, the country is sick economically. How do these things affect black people, poor people? Let's get down to the nitty-gritty. Y'all all right?
It's going to be a different kind of lecture, but you just bear with me. The country is in a state of severe unemployment and poverty. And this condition is not getting better, it's worsening. The cost of living has placed the American dream beyond the reach of the majority of the American people. About 10 million Americans over age 16 are jobless. And every week the figure climbs. This figure does not include those who have dropped out of the labor market and are no longer seeking jobs. Black people make up 20% of the unemployed, and a large percentage of those who have dropped out of the job market or stopped looking for jobs altogether. And this proportion has been the same for us since the 1960s. Though the population has increased, there were more people employed in 1989 than there are in 1992. Millions of workers have been displaced by plant closings and relocations in foreign markets, such as Mexico, where labor cost is a fraction of U.S. labor costs. Since 1980, over 2 million manufacturing jobs have vanished in America, while at the same time, the adult population has risen 11%. If you can get a job, you become one of the working poor. This is because most of the job openings are in low-skill positions that pay only the minimum wage. The average real wage is lower today than 20 years ago, meaning that the check you bring home today buys less than it did 20 years ago. Now, I want you to pay good attention to these figures. Once the figures are in your head, they begin to send a clear signal telling us what has to be done by black leaders and by black people if we're going to survive. Listen to this. In 1989, the top 4% of America's families and individuals earned as much as half the country's working labor wages put together. I want to say that again. The top 4% families and individuals, that means the super rich 4%, earned as much as one half of all of the labor force and their wages put together. That is immoral. That the gross labor of half of the labor force, just 4% of America's wealthy, are getting more than half the people who are working combined. And President Bush has the nerve to come before the American people and talk about he is for the masses, he's for family value, he's for education. Do you believe that? I want to make it clear. You can vote for Beelzebub. You can vote for Satan. You can vote for the four beasts of Revelations. You can vote for the devil. Any one of these votes will get you hell. I'm not here advocating voting for one evil above another so that the voter can say, well, we took the lesser evil. Hell, it's time to give up taking evil and find something good that you can put your vote on.
Blacks and Hispanics suffer more than white folk from unemployment. Those that are employed make only 60% of what white folk make. One study shows that if we track the closing of the gap between white and black income, blacks will not achieve income parity until the year 2420. That means 428 years from today, we might become equal to white folks in terms of income. Now look, brother, look, sister, look, leader. You look like a fool trying to sell your people this idea that we should wait on some benevolent white man to come into the White House before we can do better. Until the black man and woman realize that no benevolent white man in the White House is going to make things better for us, but it is when we unite and pool our resources intellectually and financially, we can make and will make a future for ourselves and our children. Until the black man and woman realize that no benevolent white man in the White House is going to make things better for us, but it is when we unite and pool our resources intellectually and financially, we can make and will make a future for ourselves and our children.
$30 million Americans live in poverty, and 10 million of those are black. One third of the total black population lives in poverty, and nearly half of all black children are growing up in poverty. We're growing up in conditions that give us a higher propensity toward disease and malnutrition and death. And each succeeding generation is passed into what is called a permanent underclass. So when you go to the polls to vote, which one of the candidates has spoken to your needs and your condition? During the debates, when the plight of black people was mentioned, which one of them did you hear speak forthrightly about you and your children and your needs? Not one. No, not one. The ones who claim to be your friends, they are saying, trust me, I can't speak forthrightly to black issues lest I lose middle white America. You know that white America does not want to hear about these black issues. But trust me, when I get in, I'll do the right thing by you. How many of you in 1992 will eat up that garbage and pass that on to your people as a promise? How many times have we been promised? And every time we put our trust in those who promised us, how many times was that promise fulfilled? Not one time. History says we can't trust your promise. History says we got to put our trust in God and in the Word of God and in our own power to deliver ourselves from the condition that 400 years of slavery has put us in. So our standard of living is sinking, and there's no sign of relief in sight. We're like the great Titanic that no one thought would ever go down.
But America is sinking, brothers and sisters. And changing captains on a sinking ship will not stop the ship from sinking. We need to change the ship. Well, what do you mean, Brother Farrakhan? I mean, there has to be total reconstruction of the ship. You just can't do patchwork on a ship that's going under. But the problem we have is getting the ship to dry dock before she sinks so we can work on the ship. We don't have a life raft. Your lifestyle is killing you.
Come on, teach on that.
Black people, your lifestyle is killing you. To the people of America, your lifestyle is killing you. Living in America's cities has become like living in a war zone. Street crime has become the norm throughout America's cities and even in many of her suburbs. It's difficult to walk the streets in America without the fear of being assaulted or actually experiencing assault. It's difficult to drive your car in the ghetto without the threat of being carjacked. Somebody may kill you over a bull's jacket, stick you up over a gold chain or some Air Jordan shoes. Dope has become the major employer in urban America. The dope industry is a $300 billion industry, three times the size of General Motors, the number one company of the Fortune 500. And drugs are the primary cause behind street violence. Over 1 million suspected drug violators were arrested last year. And guess what? According to the National Victim Center, nearly 750,000 women were raped last year. A third of these rapes takes place among children. On top of this, another 2 million women are the victims of wife beating. And at the root of most arguments in the home, at the root of domestic violence is money or the lack of it. Yet the same president who has shown no compassion for unemployment and the poor says he's for promoting family values. We now have over 1 million inmates in America's jails and prisons, making America the world's leader in incarceration rates, outstripping South Africa. Bigger than the drug industry and street crime in terms of dollars is white collar crime. Now, they don't talk about white-collar crime. They talk about you. Snatching pocketbooks, snatching gold chains, selling crack cocaine. You make the headlines. But the real criminals, we don't know anything about. Let's look at what the real criminals have cost America. All praise is due to Allah. Did you know the S&L, the savings and loan bailout, is $500 billion of the taxpayers' money? Michael Milken and Ivan Boesky beat the economy out of billions of dollars with their junk bond scheme that bankrupted the savings and loan industry. These kinds of crimes have eroded public confidence and placed an added burden on all the taxpayers. Among all the countries in the world, America ranks 20th in life expectancy. Though America spends more on health care than any other nation, the death rate, particularly for blacks, is near that of third world nations. Over the past 10 years, AIDS has particularly threatened the black community. Of the 200,000 AIDS deaths, 1/4 of those deaths were black. And black children make up 50% of children's cases of AIDS. So how we are living, our lifestyle is killing us. You drink too much. You smoke too much. We eat too much of the wrong kinds of food. We're too lazy to go to the market and shop. Too lazy to prepare our foods properly. So we go to the supermarket and buy chemical death in cans. Preservatives more deadly and longer term than what they use in embalming fluid. We're killing ourselves because we don't wish to cook. So Wendy's, Burger King, McDonald's, Taco Bell, and all the rest of them that you and I attend because it's quick, keeping your lifespan short. I heard on television the other night something that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad had been telling us for years. Sometimes we don't believe that Elijah Muhammad was a divinely inspired man until white folks say that he said something wise. That's very sad, but it's true. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said to us, there is no set time for the original man to die. I'm going to say that again. He said, there is no set time for you to die. He died because his time came. No, he died because he didn't do right. So white folks came on television and said they've been studying this and they've discovered that there's no set time for man to die. But by not living in harmony with nature's laws and divine law, you trigger the forces of death and you get on away from here at an early time. This body is the most magnificent of God's creation. It is greater than the sun, greater than the moon, greater than the stars. The Quran says, I have made you in the best of makes, in the best of molds. This body is enabled by God to live 200, 300, 400, 500, 600, 700, 800, 900, 1,000 years until you get so tired of seeing the cycle of birth and death and marriage and birth and death and marriage. So you just say, well, I'm tired now. I think I'll go on and take my rest. But you can't live like that. You can't live like that because the way you have been taught to live, taught to eat, the way you've been trained to think is sending us to an early grave. Well, what's happening with the development of the people? Are the American people being properly developed? Are the institutions that serve us nurturing us along the lines that God would have us nurture?
No, sir.
America's schools have fallen behind almost every industrialized country. Almost 20% of today's youth drop out of school.
That's right.
About 90% of those who stay graduate incompetent in reading, comprehension, math, and science, contributing to a society of nearly 20% functional illiterates. It's difficult to walk the school grounds or even the school building's hallways without being robbed or threatened by someone with a gun or a knife. With all of these problems, it's clear to me, and it should be clear to you, that this country is in serious trouble. And it's not just on a sick bed, but the vital sign shows she's gasping for life. And with all of these problems, you would think that the leadership would be coming up with creative solutions for the people. But instead of facing the truth and focusing in on fixing the problems, the leadership engages in what's called gridiron politics and scapegoating of the poor.
That's right.
And if a person comes along with a realistic solution, they call the solution radical and the person an extremist.
That's
right. I ask you, if your vital signs physically look like America's economically, would you want business as usual?
No, sir.
Would you want moderation? Or would you want to see some scurrying around as you see in the emergency room when there's a life-threatening situation? It will take radical solutions when you're at death's door. The president has become a cheerleader. We're number one. We're still number one. It's really pathetic to see a man of his knowledge and brilliance reduced to a cheerleader. He can't run on his record because he's a part of the record of Reagan and Bush, which is sinking the country. So he must become a cheerleader, reminding the silly voters, don't you remember? We're number one. We're number one. We can't have a long, protracted surgery on America's condition. These problems need to be fixed, and fixed right away. Brothers and sisters, if the people knew their condition, they would be willing to take the proper medicine, no matter how bad it tastes, if that medicine would correct the condition. I know, you like me, I don't like medicine. But if I'm sick and I want to get well, I'll take it. It tastes bad, I hold my nose, give it to me. Because all that a man has will he give for his life. The American people would be willing to sacrifice if they knew the truth. If a doctor told you that you were fine and you were severely ill, and that doctor would not prescribe the proper medicine for your illness, that doctor could be charged and found guilty of malpractice. But what about a president who makes you think everything is fine and you're sick, and he won't prescribe the proper medicine or solution to relieve the country of its ill? What about the malpractice of a leader of a country? How did America in the last 12 years go from the leading creditor nation to the leading debtor nation? The American taxpayer is a slave to servicing a skyrocketing debt, a debt that is so large that it sentences the children in the future to the same servitude to this debt, because the politicians are not courageous enough to deal honestly with this problem and present the American people with a real solution. It's dangerous, brothers and sisters, to enslave a people and be the perpetual source of opposition to truth, and yet say you believe in God. God has always come to the aid of the oppressed and the enslaved, even against the rich and the powerful, when they deprive others of the essentials of life, which is freedom, justice, and equality, that which you say constitutes the base of this country. When the slaves were enamored with the riches of Pharaoh, Moses wasn't able to get his people to listen to him until Moses prayed for God's hand to be set against the wealth of Egypt. The more Egypt declined, the more the slaves inclined their ears to the message of Moses.
That's right.
To get up and go for self.
That's right.
Well,
come on.
You like that?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Elijah Muhammad told us years and years ago, He said, get up, black man, and do for yourself before you're forced to do it. He showed us and told us that the plants would close and we would be outside those plants looking for a job. He said, pool your resources, hurry! And we sported and played, but now Pharaoh's got a problem. The rich man is hurting. Now your ears are more inclined and your heart is more inclined to a message to get you up and doing for yourself. You know, whenever a country is messed up like this, God always chooses somebody.
Listen.
He doesn't let the country go without warning, and that warning and that guidance is mercy from God. God is so magnificent and magnanimous to people who reject him, disbelieve in him. Still out of love and respect for his own integrity, he will not allow you to sink without a warning first. He chooses from the despised and the rejected and puts the solution in the head of a slave. So if you don't have any respect for human life or for the class of the person in whose head the solution is, then you'll miss the solution to your problems. In the book of Esther, God put the problem, the solution, in the head of Queen Esther, a woman. Queen Esther uncovered a plot that would have caused unjust death to be visited upon the Jewish people, but the king was not a sexist. He heard her warning, he heeded her warning, and he spared the Jews, thereby sparing himself from the wrath of God. If that king had been inclined towards sexism, he would have rejected her warning and he would have sentenced himself and his country to the chastisement of God. Sexism is sinking America. Classism is sinking America. Racism is sinking America. White supremacy is sinking America. And black inferiority and a slave mentality is sinking black people in this country. So, my brothers and sisters, I am saying to you, we must be open to truth no matter from whom it comes. No matter the source, because the ultimate source is God himself. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said, if you're used to eating out of a gold bowl and get hungry, don't reject food because it comes in an old pot. You hungry? Take the food or die in your folly. God has chosen from among the former slaves. And he has put in our heads a light, a torchlight, out of America's worsening condition for black people and for all of America. But America's treatment of us, the Muslims, America's treatment of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is like the proud kings of Babylon. It's terrible that you label me a Hitler. You label me a hater. You label me an anti-Semite so that you can justify your people or your agents from among our people killing me. This is hiding the light. This is scapegoating. And the reason you desire to hide the truth is you want to continue to feed your own greed. You don't desire to live in a free society, a just society, and an equal society for all of the country's people. You are a rebel against God, and as Jesus said, you are of your father the devil, and the lusts of your father you shall do. He was a murderer in the beginning and abode not in the truth. And any man who will not speak or abide in the truth is a murderer of the human spirit and the law of liberty, for only truth gives us true liberty. And this is why it is written that it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to see the kingdom of God. The rich are unwilling to sacrifice to lift the poor because of their basic greed and immorality. And therefore, today, the rich are in trouble. So the scripture says, come now, you rich man, weep and howl for your miseries that shall come upon you. Your riches are corrupted and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and your silver are cankered, and the rest of them shall be a witness against you and shall eat your flesh as though it were fire. You have heaped treasure together for the last days. Behold, the hire of the laborers who have reaped down your fields, which is of you kept back by fraud, crieth. And the cries of them who have reaped have entered into the ears of the Lord of the Sabbath. You have lived in pleasure on the earth and been wanton. You have nourished your hearts as in the day of slaughter. You have condemned and killed the just, and he does not resist you. And so, my beloved brothers and sisters, the country has a serious problem, as in deep trouble, and needs a torchlight out of the abyss of darkness. Every black man or woman that has risen up among us to warn America, teach America, guide America, by guiding us, America has killed them. We lost Martin Luther King, not because King was a bad man. We lost Martin Luther King because America did not want to hear a word that would make her a just society.
That's right.
So America kills your leaders. America kills your leaders and then names streets after them. But the leader's dream dies and you ride on Martin Luther King Boulevard. They reduce Martin Luther King to a simple word, we have a dream. They reduce Malcolm X to by any means necessary. They kill your leaders and then give you your leaders in debt to blind you to the living wrong that God never takes one from you. That he don't give you one to comfort you. Look at your scripture, Reverend. When Jesus was about to go, he knew he was going to die. He said, I will pray the Father that he will send you another comforter. I'm not going to leave you comfortless. So even when God takes one that you love, look around, there's another one somewhere coming on up to carry the torch. But of course, if you watch the American white people, they never glorify their dead. They bury their dead, celebrate the living, follow the living, and remember the best of their dead. You don't hear them talking about John Kennedy every day. John Kennedy was. Bill Clinton is. So they're not telling you vote for Kennedy. They're telling you vote for Clinton. Abraham Lincoln was. Bush is. They're not telling you vote for Abraham Lincoln. Stay with Bush. That's what they're saying. But when it comes to you, they kill your leaders. Then when they feel the time is right, they resurrect them and give you dead leaders to blind you to living realities. There is no dead man that can lead a living people. You say, wait a minute, Jesus is my leader. Jesus is not dead. You say, Muhammad is my leader. Muhammad is not dead. You say, Moses is my leader. I say, Moses is not dead. Because there is no grave that can hold the divine spirit of life that emanates from a prophet or servant of God. So you ask, Brother Farrakhan, what is your guidance for black people? And what is your guidance for America? If America wants to come out of debt, there's no way that she can come out of it without reducing spending. And she must increase taxes. That's a bitter pill for anybody to swallow. But America gotta come clean. Come to the American people and say, look, we're in trouble. We need your help. Will you tighten your belt for a few years? Will you save over here and give over here so we can balance the budget, so we can put a future in front of our children? The American people would sacrifice. You did it in World War II. I was a baby, and I saw my mother in the kitchen taking fat from the frying pan and putting it in tin cans, saving the fat because the war industry needed the fat. Evidently, it had some use in making bullets. I saw my poor mother go into the 5 and 10 cent store to sell war stamps and war bonds, to sacrifice hours of her time so that America could survive. The spirit is in the people to sacrifice, but when you lie to them, when you make them think everything is all right when everything is all wrong, then the people say to hell with paying more taxes because I don't trust the leader who's asking me to sacrifice because he's been a liar in the past. Look at the Nation of Islam. We have no money. But we do with no money what you can't do with all your money. We are offering you a torchlight, a way out of this. America has to be honest. Clinton is right. They have to tax the rich. Did you know that the rich have gotten away with murder? Did you know that more than 80% of the taxes are paid by the American public? In fact, 83% of all taxes are paid by the people. Only 17% of taxes are paid by the corporations. In the 1950s, the corporations used to make up 39% of the total taxing of the American people. Now the corporations are paying only 17%. Who made the law that let the rich out, that let the corporations out, and put the burden of government on the poor? Who did this? Just give me a few more minutes. I want to show you the wickedness that's been going on in government. You, the poor, you put your money in savings and loans. But the Congress makes laws giving the rich loopholes out of paying taxes. The poor people have no real advocates. Most of the congresspersons, those in the Senate and the House of Representatives, they're not poor like you or me. Those persons come from the privileged class of people. Is that true? They are from the rich for the most part. Since they're from the rich, they make laws to protect the riches of the rich. Now, did you know that it was Congress who passed laws to make it easy for corporations to borrow billions of dollars from the banks?
instead of the corporations using the money to update their plants, retrain their workers, they use your money to close down the plant and open up a new one overseas with the government's permission, putting the same worker who put their money in the banks out of a job. Are you listening? That's kind of vicious, isn't it? Now they put the job in Mexico, in Taiwan, or somewhere else where labor is cheap. You don't have a job. And when you go to the bank, you can't borrow money. It's your little money in the bank. You can't even get an automobile to tell you, well, your credit's not good enough. Your bank account's not fat enough. But the rich can take the money of the poor and sink it into foreign plants. So now that the savings and loan industry is in trouble, Mr. Bush could find a half a trillion dollars quickly. You in trouble. The cities are in trouble. He haven't found nothing for you yet. We, the Nation of Islam, I want you to study the nation. Look at us. We come from the poor. We were the drug users. We were the whiskey drinkers. We were the gang bangers. We were the criminals. We were college people with no direction for our life. But the Honorable Elijah Muhammad called us to a purpose and made our lives useful. You say, oh, come on, Farrakhan. That little small group of people you have with you, I mean, so what? You know what's interesting to me? After the debates the other night, they took a poll. Maybe 70 million people watched the debates.
Yes, sir.
They didn't poll 70 million people. They took a representative sampling. And then they came back after that representative sampling to tell us how the people thought about who won the debate. White folk, you call that scientific?
Go ahead, your boss, go ahead.
They get 1,200 people. CNN, Gallup poll.
This is the way America feels about Clinton, about Bush.
Well, I got more than a sampling.
That's right.
We got them in the nation from every walk of life.
That's right.
And I don't care what you say about Farrakhan, examine my work. For my work is a testimony that I'm on the same path that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad put me on, and that is a successful path. Every brother that comes into the nation, he gotta have a job. If he doesn't have a job, he has to be able to create a job, or we create one for him. But nobody can hang around in the nation doing nothing.
Good teacher.
The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said, welfare meant farewell to self-reliance. Farewell to self-independence. Farewell to the growth and development of self. But I want to say that I'm a child of welfare. I know that it is necessary to have a safety net under the people, but it is wrong for the people to abuse that safety net. My mother was not a welfare abuser. I watched that woman take her pennies and use them wisely from her welfare check. And she would sit at her machine at night
and sew dresses and whatnot to make extra money to give me my music lessons and my brother. So when the social worker came to our home, she saw a clean house that you could eat off the floor. She saw decent furniture, an organized home. And she asked my mother, how could you get this kind of home on what we give you for welfare? My mother, in her clipped West Indian accent, said to the social worker, and you think I want to live off of just that little meager thing you give me? You don't think I aspire for the better things in life? She said, but you need to report that you are making more money than what we give. She said, Jean, come. Alvin, come. Bring your violin. Sit down at the piano. Play for the woman. And when that woman heard us play, she broke down in tears. She said, I want for my children what you want for yours. And so I take in sewing at night to give my children a chance to make something better of themselves than I was able to make of myself. Listen, brothers and sisters. All praise is due to Allah. When I graduated from high school, a welfare check came to my house, and my mother took the check and walked back to the welfare office and gave it to the woman and said, I thank you for helping me to get my child through high school, and now I will take it from here. That was a proud black woman. That was a decent black woman. Submit to you that there are countless hundreds of thousands of black women out there just like my mother who don't want to be on welfare, but they're thankful to God that there is welfare, but they would want to get off of welfare, shouldn't they? Of course they should. How do you get them off? The government of America is spending 0.05% of her gross national product in retraining the American worker. That's criminal. The American worker has given to America everything, and the government is giving to the American worker little or nothing. When you hear President Bush talk about keeping the troops at a certain level in Europe, and Clinton talking about reducing the troops because there's no longer a threat of nuclear war, you have to ask yourself, they have already reduced some of the troop levels. Those troops are coming back to America. What are they coming back to? Where are they going to work? Who's going to retrain them to fit them into a service-oriented economy? The government is not spending the money. Even the veterans who come home sick, the government is trying to get out of paying them. They're just due. Oh, man. Well, what is your torchlight, Farrakhan? We submit that the government needs to re-educate the people, stimulate the people to make a sacrifice. Everything we in the nation have, we got it because these that believe made a sacrifice. We don't order or take their money. We teach them and they give their money. So we're able to buy schools and farmland and set up newspaper plant. It is because we make the sacrifice to get what we want. The American people will make that sacrifice if the government would be honest. Television is so greedy. They love money and profit. over the well-being of America's thought processes. And so they feed the American public entertainment. Foolishness, when the television could be used to educate the American people almost overnight. Do you know that each one of these that are with me, they eat the best of foods?
That's right.
They have a dietary law that they follow.
Yeah, that's right.
And if we follow the dietary law and teachings given to us by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, that's our health insurance plan.
Yeah.
We have preventive medicine.
That's right. Yeah.
So that we are not in the hospitals with these expensive operations. We are trying to heal ourselves through preventive measures. All America needs to do is use the airwaves properly. Teach the American people what foods to eat, how best to cook it. Teach the American mother how to take care of her body, how to look after her baby, how to clean up the environment of that household. And you will find disease going down and health going up. And the health care cost that is over $1 trillion, you could cut that cost and put that money into revitalizing the cities and the infrastructure of the cities. It's not hard, but you just gotta be honest. We're healthy.
Yes, sir.
We're strong. I'll be 60 years old in a few months. Wait. You don't know what I'm about to say. I'm not any decrepit 60-year-old man. I'm not a weak 60-year-old man. I'm a strong 60-year-old man. No. I'm not saying this for vanity's sake. I don't believe in sickness, and I don't believe in dying till I'm ready. Some may believe they can help me think a little better on dying, but I would advise America to leave me alone. I don't think it's wise for America. I don't think it's wise for black people. I don't think it's wise for those who don't like me because you don't understand or disagree with me philosophically or ideologically or religiously. I don't think it's wise for you to plan to do harm to me.
Go ahead. That's right.
I didn't come this far without a God. And the more America and others try to hurt me, the more you find God helping me. This is not an accident that happened here tonight. This is the reality that God is with Brother Farrakhan. And he's with me because I'm standing with his servant, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, a man that God gave a torchlight for America and a torchlight for you. America must allow business ownership in the black community.
That's right.
Whenever a company is falling apart, you notice they make the workers part owners of the company. People love to own something. Black people don't own where we live.
That's right.
Now, if you really want to help the cities, let's go into partnership with the people who live in the cities. Bring back the businesses and make the workers part owners. Then we'll work long hours because we're working for ourselves. Let's share the profits. You're doing it for others. Why not do it for the cities? We can rebuild the wasted cities.
That's right.
We have talented craftsmen that don't have jobs. And the cities are falling down. Brothers and sisters, we have a 3-year economic savings plan that was advanced by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad in 1964. We reinstituted it last year. I'm asking all of you to help me, help us to help ourselves. If you trust me,
yes.
And you should,
yes, sir.
And you can,
that's right.
I don't need your money to buy a suit. I have a suit.
Right.
I don't need your money to buy a car. I have one or two. I don't need your money to live in a nice home. I already live in a fine home, thanks to Allah and the believers. It belongs to them. I own nothing. When I leave this planet, everything that I have worked for does not belong to a few. It belongs to the community that I have been birthed to serve. I own nothing personal. Say, why not, man? I've seen so many people scuffle their life to have money and leave it to foolish children. And that fool will take that person's life earnings and blow it in 3 months.
Right?
If you look at the prophets of God, they didn't work for themselves, they worked for their community. And when they died, they left what they made to the community, because we as individuals die, but the community lives. Brothers and sisters, this 3-year economic savings plan, we are asking all of our people, if you would just sacrifice $10 a month, allow us to save that money for 3 years. Then let us turn that money into farmland so we can begin to grow food, to feed ourselves, to clothe ourselves, to shelter ourselves. We have to do for ourselves. I'm asking the government, since you have given tax breaks to the rich, why not? Since you don't have money to throw away or really to give away, let us use the $300 billion that we get out of the American economy to build up where we live. And instead of America taking our tax dollars away from us, give us back some of our tax dollars into the 3-year economic savings plan that black people can invest in building something for themselves. I say this because, leaders, you can't go to white folks now and ask them, give me. Bush is not going to give you nothing if he gets back in. If Clinton gets in, he'll tell you, I'm sorry, we really don't have it. If Perot gets in, he will tell you, we're tightening our belt. You can't be a beggar with this mentality. Our people are sentenced to death. We got to realize creative ways. Yes, America owes us. We know that. Last time I was here, we added it up. And it comes to billions and billions and billions and billions of dollars. But America doesn't have that to give. So if we get $300 billion out of the economy and we pay billions more in taxes, why can't the government, we appeal to the government to allow us to own where we live, bring the factories back into the black community, but they won't come back until crime goes down. Don't say that we can't lessen the crime, because we are practically a crime-free community.
That's right.
We respect law and order. You don't find Muslims gang-banging, shooting, stealing, cutting.
That's right.
We live a clean, moral life for the most part. We're not saying we're perfect.
That's right.
But we are relatively free from all the things that is killing the society. Take a pattern, look at us. We got our own schools. Good schools.
Yes, sir.
We graduated our first 10 students out of high school this year. 4 of them in who's who of high school American students, in the top 5% of all of the high school students in America. All 10 on their way to college to bring that knowledge back to help black people get up from where we are. We don't have to sit around waiting on white people to prepare a future for us. we can prepare a future for ourselves. In fact, we must do it. And so, my beloved brothers and sisters, as we come to our conclusion, I appeal to you to look at us as an example of what can be achieved when you have the proper state of mind and connectedness with the Lord of the worlds. Please don't leave. Wait just a minute. We're at the end. We can show you what that Bible that you've got on your shelf can do if you use it right. Reverend, with deep respect, every one of these that are followers of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad were made right out of that same Bible that is in your house gathering dust. You marvel at our cleanliness. You marvel at our discipline. You marvel at our unity. It's there in the book. If you will allow us to help you use the Bible properly, we can make millions of black people disciplined and strong. This Quran, the revelation of God to Prophet Muhammad of Arabia, is an advancement of the Mosaic law. With the Bible nurturing us and the Quranic law guiding us, we have become a strong, disciplined, organized community in the midst of the chaos of our people. We don't have guns. Our people respect us because they know we respect them. We go to our people with a moral imperative that appeals to their nature as the people of God. And so, my brothers and sisters, as we leave you, the 13th of October marks the quincentennial year of the discovery of this country. And since that day, we've had three debates concerning the presidency of the United States. And black people, Hispanic people, and the Native American people of this country have been neglected. Did you know that the very seal of the United States government in July 1776, three men were asked to form a committee to develop that seal? Ben Franklin, John Adams, Thomas Jefferson. And did you know that the seal of the United States government, the first seal that was proposed, was a coat of arms of six quarters with emblems representing Holland, Scotland, Ireland, France, Germany, and Holland, the countries which peopled the new nation? That original seal had nothing to do with black people, nothing to do with Native Americans, nothing to do with Arabs, nothing to do with Hispanic. It had everything to do with Caucasians. These were Masons, high degree Masons. Listen carefully, Masons, Shriners. For the reverse side of the seal, they suggested a picture of Pharaoh sitting in an open chariot with a crown on his head and a sword in his hand, pursuing the children of Israel as they were fleeing through the Red Sea. Hovering over the sea was to be shown a pillar of fire in a cloud, expressive of the divine presence and command, with light coming out of the cloud, shining on the face of Moses as he extended his hand over the sea, causing it to overwhelm Pharaoh. And the motto on that first seal was, rebellion to tyrants is obedience to God. Now, why did the founding fathers put Moses and Pharaoh on the first design of the seal representing the United States of America. Brothers and sisters, this is why many members of the Jewish community are angry with Brother Farrakhan. I'm not anti-Semitic. I never have been. I don't hate Jews. I never have. I hate the term anti-Semitic because its usage is bigoted. Jews are not the only Semitic people. There are many Semitic people who are not Jews, and they don't hate me, and they don't call me anti-them. I'm not anti-Semitic. I'm not anti-Jewish. I have some very strong opinions that are theological at their root, not political, theological. Mr. Perot, Mr. Clinton, and Mr. Bush can't fix this economy because God himself has set his hand against the economy. And he set his hand against this economy because the root problem of this nation is you and what America is going to do with the unwanted presence of 30 million black people. Listen, listen, listen. You, black people, we are saying God has chosen us. That's the base of the argument. They are angry with me because I say God chose us, the foolish, the despised, the rejected of the world, to be his people in this day and time for a specific purpose. Don't call me anti-Semitic. Argue with me from scripture. Don't call me anti-Semitic. Argue with me from scripture. Come on then, let's sit down and talk about it. If I'm lying or in error, I'm not too proud. I'll come before the world and say, I was wrong, I'm sorry. We're not the chosen of God. But now, wait a minute, wait a minute. Some of my Muslim brothers and sisters will say God does not have a chosen people.
Teach it, brother, sir, teach it.
God does not have a chosen people in the way those who claim to be chosen have used that term. But to say that God does not choose is a lie. To say that God does not elect a people and a prophet at a certain time for a certain purpose is misquoting, misunderstanding scripture. And I want you to listen well. God chose Israel for a specific purpose. And when she failed in that purpose, he punished her and sent prophets to keep calling her back to that purpose. God then goes out of Israel and he chooses among the Arabs. And he chose Muhammad, peace be upon him. And the first adherents to his philosophy and religion were Arabs. They became chosen for a purpose to spread this book, Quran, to the ends of the earth. And I submit to you that you have failed. How did you fail? A new hemisphere opened with 500 million people who have never heard of Allah, never heard of Prophet Muhammad, have a corrupted idea of Moses, Jesus, and the prophets of God. Where are you missionaries to spread the word of Allah. You're not here.
That's right.
You're busy pursuing the American dream. And you have left off the words of the prophet and the mission of the prophet. So God is not waiting on you. If I had money to build a building and I hire an architect to draw up the plans, I ask people to submit their bid for election and selection of a construction company. When the construction company is chosen, it's news for one day. Then work begins. We don't walk around every day saying, you know, I'm the construction company that was chosen. I'm the chosen company. I'm the chosen company. And ain't no work being done. If you're chosen, get on the job. If you're chosen, go to work and prove that God has chosen you to do a job. Are you listening? We say, God ain't waiting on you. He has chosen again from among the foolish, the despised, the rejected, the unloved, the unwanted. He said, I'll choose a man from Georgia.
Go ahead.
Why Georgia?
Go ahead,
it's a state where black people have suffered like no black people have ever suffered in the history of the world. I choose out of Georgia. I'm going to choose me a man that got the right heart for the mission, the right spirit for the mission, the love of the people, and I'm going to put my words in his mouth. And he will speak unto them all that I shall command him. What is his name? Behold, before the great and dreadful day of the Lord, I will send you Elijah. And Elijah will turn the hearts of the children to their fathers. You didn't hear Elijah, but I was blessed to meet Elijah. I was blessed to know Elijah. I was blessed to be taught by Elijah. He raised me up from a little boy. He took me away from my foolish career. He cleaned up my dirty mouth and my dirty life. And he made me to bow down to Allah. He cleaned me up from wine and whiskey and drugs. He cleaned me up from lust for the strange woman. He made a man out of me. He made a woman out of my wife. And he gave us the right kind of knowledge that we could be an example for our 9 children. A time would come when he wouldn't be here any longer. But the torch light, he didn't take it with him. Just like it was with Elijah, when Elisha said, what, master, can I do if I see you go away? He said, if you see me go away, I will give you a double portion of my spirit. I'll put the torchlight in your hand, Elisha, and then you will go and do like you see me do. This is no more than what Jesus did for Peter. When Jesus left, he said, Peter, on this rock, I build my church. Peter, whom you bind on earth, I'm going to bind in heaven. Peter, teach forgiveness. Even though, Peter, you're a weak man who got weak in faith and denied me, yet I see value in you, Peter. So even though Jesus was gone, Jesus was present. Gone, but the light was in Peter. The light was in Paul. The light was in James. The light was in John. Prophet Muhammad had to go away, but he wasn't wasn't going to leave the people without a light. He said, this book and my example I leave with you. But I know you're living people and you need living people to lead living people. So I leave you Abu Bakr. I leave you Umar. I leave you Uthman. I leave you Ali. I leave you my wife Aisha and my other wives. Go now and take the gospel into all the world. Elijah's gone, but Elijah lives. Elijah's gone, but Elijah's present. Where is Elijah? He's here. In me. I have abundance of his spirit. You can't beat me down. You can't talk me down. You can't slander me down. There ain't nothing you can do to break me down. I'm standing on a firm foundation, and I will not be denied. I'm lifting up a light in the darkness. I'm lifting up a light in the darkness. So I say to the Jewish people,
all right, listen. Better listen.
Why won't you sit down?
Come on. Good question.
You say I'm all of these things. Let's sit down and talk about it. Why don't you want to sit down? You say, well, we're not going to sit down until you repudiate all the things you've said. What things? Then you don't want to sit down. Because I can't be an unprincipled man and say one thing yesterday and another thing today if I haven't been changed by superior knowledge.
Yes, sir.
I believe what I said. I can't apologize for what your people wrote in the press and put in my mouth. And whatever I said, I stand on what I said. Now, if I am a liar or false, then you have the truth. Sit down and share your truth with me. And if I'm wrong, then I'll submit. But let's not go in no dark room. I ain't going with you in no back room. You see, because you've come to my brothers here. These are my brothers and my sisters. You wait until I'm gone, and you tell them he's a hater, he's an anti-Semite, we ought to have nothing to do with him. Why do you listen to them? You know how you stop slander? You know how you stop backbiting? You never lend yourself to it. When somebody comes talking about somebody else, you keep quiet. Then you wait until the person they have talked to you about is in the presence of the one who did the talking. And then you say, oh, brother, oh, sister, I'm trying to be a sister or brother to you both. So why don't you say in her presence what you said to me about her behind her back? When you do it like that, you spine people start, but no, I didn't mean it like that. I'm so sorry. No, you misunderstood me, child. Oh, no. So they say they want to meet with the black clergy after we're out of town. What are you going to say to the black clergy in our absence that you can't say in our presence? I don't think the black clergy should meet with you. I don't think the black clergy should meet with you because you refuse to respect the mayor's wish. The mayor wished that when I came to the city, we could sit down and let peace and a new page begin from the city of Atlanta. We were willing to do that. You come with preconditions. We got to apologize for everything we ever said or did that you didn't like. Well, do you think we don't have some things that you got to apologize for? We haven't made that kind of demand on you. We didn't help bring your father into slavery. You helped bring our fathers into slavery. Some of your people did. And you write about it, and you know it's true. You talk about Arabs, you talk about white people who enslaved us, but you never say nothing about what you did. We didn't ask you to apologize. Let's come sit down. We didn't ask you to apologize for making us step and fetch it. Giving us these old Aunt Jemima roles in Hollywood. Feeding the stereotype that we are some subhuman species. We didn't ask you to apologize for that. We don't ask you to apologize for exploiting our ignorance. Come, let's sit down at the table. You're going to have to do it one day, whether you like it or not. I'm not going any place. I'm not a beggar. I can live without you. You can't cut off my blessings. You don't have a ladder tall enough to get to heaven to cut off my blessings. But you don't have no power bigger than the power of the God that I represent. He'll smash you in the twinkling of an eye. One more Andrew may come through, bringing Sally with her.
Go ahead, dear Holy Apostle.
Let's sit down and talk. I got a lot to talk to you about. You got a lot to talk to us about. But I don't think we should do it in the back room. Since the television has been used to make me the Hitler.
Go ahead, dear Apostle.
Since the media has led to say Farrakhan is a hater of all white people.
That's what they say. Go ahead, then.
You see my color? That's because you in my blood. Master Farad Muhammad, the great Mahdi and teacher of Elijah Muhammad, is near as white as any white person. If I hate white people, I would hate him then for his color. There's some of my own people that are so light, so bright, that we couldn't tell them they're passing. And when they come home, we embrace them. We're not angry with you because of your color. Your color didn't lynch us. The wickedness inside the color is what lynched us.
Right.
Just sit down and talk.
You should apologize.
Don't have preconditions. Let's talk. As if you want to. If you don't want to, I'm going to continue doing my work. You can do everything you can to hinder us. Put a bushel basket over the light. But Allah says in the Quran, he's going to perfect his light. Though the polytheists may be adverse. So if you are angry and pained because our people have accepted us in Atlanta, forget it. These are our people. We love them. They love us. We have differences, but we love each other. You'll never get Farrakhan to go against my Christian brothers and sisters. No, no, no. That's where I had my beginning, in the church. I love the church. Yeah. And the knowledge that Elijah Muhammad gave me, I'm bringing it right back to the church. So we all can grow together, be strong together, work together for the common good of all of our people. So if you're angry because we're together, I'm very sorry about that. If you're in pain because they invite us to sit with them in their councils, this is where we belong, with our people. And if they think we're wrong, let them chastise us. Not you. Your hands are too bloody. You can't chastise us. So, we're for peace. We don't bother anybody. We're not looking for trouble. But we're not running from it either. So I want to close now. Thanking you all. Thanking Atlanta. You've been so kind and wonderful to the Muslims. Thank you so very, 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 very much. Thank you to the NAACP, to Brother Hosea Williams. Thank you for the followers of Yahweh ben Yahweh, Nasi Kasiel ben Israel, and Rabbi ben Ami. Thank you for the Christian clergy. Thank you for our Native American brothers and sisters. You have made it possible for a wonderful day. Can we pray together before you leave? Let's all stand and have prayer. As you leave today, as you leave, we have an unusual videotape of one of the great interviews of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. It is 6 hours in length. Part one is being offered today. It is the historical national educational TV interview with Buzz Anderson, part one. I think on this tape he discusses Malcolm X and what happened during that fateful time in our history. How much is this tape? This tape is 1999. Also, I made a tape recently called The Attack on Black Youth. This tape, videotape, is also on sale for $14.99, and you can get the audio cassette for $5. There's also a commemorative shirt, t-shirt, with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's picture, my picture, and the Georgia Dome, and a Torchlight for America. If you'd like to have it, it's on sale outside. It's just $10. And then there are other vendors. And by the way, in your seats, there is a flyer of the 3-year economic savings plan. Take it and use it. And please back me, and I can assure you, with the help of God, we'll get our people out of this condition. Also in your seat is a flyer announcing Dr. Donald Douglas Torrey's wonderful, healthful pills that will clean you out. Clean out all the garbage that's in the system. Dr. Torrey, come over, Pat. Dr. Donald Douglas Torrey. He's one of our great, great health gurus. And I mean that in the best sense of the word. I try his pills, and I mean they clean you out. And if you don't know how much garbage we have stored up in our system, you get those pills, take them as the doctor instructs, and you'll see an address on there to write him, and all of you who would like to be distributors of his product and distributors of the nation's product, please try and get in touch with Dr. Torrey and get that product. It is a must on the health list for black people. And last, thank you, doctor. I want to say that Brother Rasul Muhammad, one of the sons of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, marched here today with approximately 200 of our homeless brothers and sisters. Where are my homeless brothers and sisters? Raise your hands high. Some of who may be in the balcony. I want to say to you, my dear brothers and sisters, you know, America just sent $10 billion to Israel to look after homeless Jews displaced from Russia to be resettled in Israel. It is sad that she can spend money abroad for the homeless abroad and neglect the condition of the homeless here. Amen. Some of these young men were soldiers. Amen. And because of an unfortunate circumstance, they're out of a home. They want to live in a home just like we live in homes. They don't want to live under bridges and in cardboard. They deserve a chance. I believe with the help of Almighty God, if that old bushel basket will be taken off of the light that we shine, and if we're given a chance to reform our people in the prisons and where they are, we'll rid our people of this homeless condition. May Allah bless you, my brothers. Stay together and come to the mosque and let us put you to work and you can get out of that homeless condition. May Allah bless you, brothers. Thank you. Next year, Allah willing, Saviors Day celebration will be held in Los Angeles, California. So let's start now and get ready for Los Angeles. And Allah willing, in 1994, where's Brother Akbar? Brother Akbar? Yes, sir. Where's Sister Akbar? Come on over here. They look real African. In 1994, Allah willing, we will have Saviors Day in Accra, Ghana. And so we got 2 years to plan and prepare to go home. Let our foot touch African soil and see what it was like, what it is like, and what it can be like with God's help. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Brother Minister.
And to all of my Orthodox, I hate to use the word Orthodox, but I use it because there's no other way to say it, my Orthodox Muslim brothers who are present, even though we have differences, I want you to know from me that we who follow the Honorable Elijah Muhammad love you and respect you. And every believer, no matter what their color, who believes in Prophet Muhammad and follows this Quran, we honor you, we respect you, and we love you. We have a mission in America. I didn't get a chance to halfway say what I wanted to say today. It just too long, too take too much time, and you don't have the time, unfortunately, and time is just getting away from us. But I plan to put what I wanted to say today in a book and work out all of the programs that we wanted to talk about today to help us and America out of this condition. But I want to say to the Muslims, you cannot make Islam successful in America until two mentalities are destroyed. The mentality of white supremacy and the mentality of black inferiority. You can't make a good Christian or a good Hebrew in America without destroying those two mentalities. And in that, you misunderstand the work of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. When he went to teach the root of white people coming out of black people, he was not doing that to produce racism or to teach racial supremacy for us to walk around with our chest poked out. But he was breaking up the mind of white supremacy and destroying the mind of black inferiority at the same time with one blow of truth. And if you could go back and look again at the teachings of Elijah Muhammad, you will see that what he taught was absolutely necessary to lay the foundation of a true brotherhood that cuts across all color lines. But in the Western Hemisphere, you will never be successful talking about Islam is a non-racial. That is baloney. Islam is non-racial, but the world is sick with racism, and so is the world of Islam. So all of it needs to have that mind destroyed. And until you understand that, you will always misunderstand we who follow the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. But we still will love you, but we will go on with our mission until the mind of the slave is totally destroyed. And the mind of the slave master is totally destroyed. And then a new mind can be created out of the old that will allow us to live in peace, freedom, justice, and equality. So with that in mind, with all of us together, would you bow your heads and pray with us? I will pray the first part of this prayer in Arabic and then in English. Qul a'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahmanir Rahim. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا صراط المستقيم مستقيم الصراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful. Praise be to Allah, the Lord of the worlds, the Beneficent, the Merciful, Master of the Day of Judgment. Thee alone do we worship, thine aid we seek. Guide us on the right path, the path of those upon whom thou hast bestowed favors, not the path of those upon whom wrath is brought down, nor of those who go astray. O Allah, we thank you for this Saviour's Day meeting in Atlanta. We thank you for all of those who are present. And we ask that you go with each and every one of us and take us safely back to our places of abode. We pray that as we came in many, that we may go out of one mind and one spirit and one accord, that we love each other, and that we will do all in our power to follow the light that has been sent down with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, that we may get up and do for ourselves before it is too late. I bear witness that there is no God but Allah, and I bear witness that Muhammad is his messenger. Amen. Thank you. May Allah bless you all. Assalamu alaikum.